case of 517 Ocean House Road LLC versus Town of Cape Elizabeth. Third item is the Wentworth Lodge Special Event Facility Site Plan Considerations. Fourth item, the Cape Elizabeth High School Generator Site Plan Amendment. Fifth item of business, Old Mill Four Lot Subdivision. Sixth item is consideration of the technical amendments to the town land use, various land use ordinances. And lastly, an opportunity for public comment on anything which, of the specific items, which hasn't had its own public comment period. First item of business, we have the approval of minutes of the previous meeting of May 17. They've been circulated. Is there any discussion by any board members? Comments? Questions? I will consider a motion to approve those minutes. Jonathan, thank you. Is there a second? Motion seconded. Any discussion on the seconded motion? There being none, I'll call for a vote. In favor? Opposed? The vote carries unanimously. Thank you. The executive session.
Excuse me. And I'm going to be the first one that reminds everyone we need to be careful, including me, about speaking into the microphone so everyone can hear us. So the question was, are there minutes for the June 7 executive session? And in fact, there are minutes. They're very, very brief minutes. They are after the regular minutes, and they're basically when you voted to go into executive session and when you voted to leave executive session.
Okay, good point. The content is not dealt with. Is there any, have a motion to approve the minutes of the executive session? Elaine, thank you. Caroline, second. Discussion on the second motion. All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. The next item of business, excuse me. Is 517 Ocean House Road LLC versus Town of Cape Elizabeth. There was litigation brought under that caption on by an order dated May 10. The Cumberland Superior Court remanded the matter to the Planning Board for additional findings of fact for a site plan which had been approved with reference to 539 to 41 Ocean House Road. The court did identify three specific issues which required additional findings. The way we'll handle this, excuse me, summarize the agenda item for the benefit of the public. We'll allow an opportunity for public comment. We will follow our usual rule of limiting the public comment period to 15 minutes with a limit of 3 minutes per speaker. At the close of the public comment period, the board may begin discussion of the remand. At the close, the board has the options of making or not making additional findings or tabling the item to future meeting. We'd like to start the summarizing of the agenda item by a presentation from our town council, John Wall. Thank you, John, if you'd like to take the podium and give us the background in this case and any observations that you have on our mission this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good evening, board members. As the chair indicated, this is on remand from the Superior Court in a Rule 80B appeal. There was an appeal challenging the site plan review approval that was given. The Superior Court Justice reviewed all of the issues and identified three, in essence, that he was requiring the board to make explicit findings of fact. So as I read the remand order from the Superior Court judge, it does not require the board to retread any ground that has already been covered, simply to make explicit findings of fact with regard to the identified issues. I believe the issues are set out in the memo from the planner, so I won't necessarily go through those line by line. I would note that a couple of those seem to have a couple of different aspects to them. It may be useful for the board to structure their discussion in terms of going one at a time, or they can deal with them together if they believe, you know, certain evidence seems to deal with more than one issue. But going from one to the next might be the most logical way of approaching this in terms of sorting through the factual findings. The board should make reference to the record materials that exist, which of course include all submissions, the information provided orally by persons testifying in front of the board. And the board should draw from that entire record whatever findings it's going to make in response to the remand. The reason the court remanded these particular issues is because the court, in its function as an appellate court in this instance under Rule 80B, is required to review the decision and determine whether or not it's supported by the record. And in part, for the court to be able to do that, it has to know what the findings were and whether or not there are materials in the record that in fact support them. So in essence, when you're finding facts as part of this remand, that's what you should be keeping in mind. Obviously, the board can be as elaborate as it wants with regard to the factual findings. But essentially, what the board really needs to do is just focus on being able to articulate findings of fact that are adequate to support the conclusions they've reached. And that can be as basic as simply identifying the relevant record information and stating why you believe that record information supports a finding that this particular criterion has been met. I'm going to, just sort of as a way to assist you in terms of that process, I'm going to take one of the approval standards that is not at issue in the remand just to give you an example of what I mean. If you look at an issue, for example, like pedestrian circulation, which is subpart C, I think it's sufficient from the court's perspective in terms of sufficient findings of fact for you to articulate that plans submitted by the applicant show walkways, paths, other types of hardscape features which connect the internal elements of the property and also relate it in an appropriate way to the other areas of the neighborhood as described in that subsection. In doing so, you articulate the specific record features or record items that you're relying upon and why you believe those items show what is required by this performance standard. So like I say, you can be as elaborate as you want, but ultimately what the court is looking for is some just explicit articulation as to record materials that demonstrate why factually there's support for this finding. I think in terms of process, the board chair has articulated sort of how you guys are going to proceed. If there's any other questions you have for me right now in terms of what the Superior Court is looking for in terms of the board on remand or any other aspect of this, I'd be happy to respond to it.
Thanks. And board members, any questions for John? Okay. Thanks, John. Just so it's apparent what we're working with, the board has received the application package, the plans. Evidently, the court was not able to access the video of the public hearing on the matter, which is unfortunate, and the staff at great expense of time made a transcript of that public hearing, which is quite useful. And I would also like to point out the memorandum which Maureen has prepared, which is I think an excellent summary of all the various pieces of information that the board has had to consider on each of these items of concern to the court. I think it was an excellent piece of staff support, and I commend her for it. So what I think we will do shortly is to go through the proposed findings, which have blanks after each one, leaving it to the board to identify the items from the record that were persuasive to them. But before we do that, I do want to get to the public comment period. And as I mentioned before, we are allowing 15 minutes with a maximum of 3 minutes per speaker. Does anybody wish to be heard on behalf from the public? Yes, ma'am. If you would give your name and address or involvement in this situation, that'd be great.
Happy to, thank you. I'm Peggy McGeehee, and I'm with Perkins Thompson. I'm here on behalf of the appellant in this case, which is 517 Ocean House. I hope you did get a copy of our letter from June 1, which comments on the court's remand. I think your attorney would tell you that it is, you know, when courts are dealing with planning boards, it's a volunteer board, they're going to give a board, you know, every benefit of the doubt. And it's unusual to have a remand. And usually it's about one issue. Here we have three. And we may recall that what we did was a number of challenges, right title and interest, water supply, buffering, financial capacity, and the court reviewed the record to see if there was evidence to support those findings. And when it found anything that was colorable, it said, I'm satisfied with that. But the court reviewed the record, including the transcript, and the town attorney advised the court that that transcript wasn't complete. It admitted something about lighting, for example. And so our view that the court did not find evidence for these particular standards, because you remember, you made just one overall finding that all the standards were met. The court didn't remand all of the standards to you, only those three. And so you did have a new transcript typed up. We compared them, didn't see that there was any new information, any evidence. It was just kind of ums were put in there, first names. It was just some typos corrected. So we do believe that there is no additional evidence for you to review in the new transcript. So beyond what we have in the letter, there's just a couple of points that I would like to make. One, it is a valiant effort that the town planner put together in that memo. Not the findings, that the way they're stated, don't necessarily match what the court has asked you to do, but I won't go into detail in 3 minutes about that. One of the important things that is not mentioned in the memo is you're supposed to make a finding on safety, and you have a new parking lot that's being put behind Building 3, and there's nothing mentioned in the planner's memo about Building Number 3 where the application says there's no lighting. And this is a safety issue where you would have the public parking in a place in the back in a bit next to a building that has no lights. So this is thing that I would ask you to include is there's supposed to be a site plan approval regarding all four buildings and not just three. The stormwater piece, there is no mention about the 2 or the 25-year storm in the findings. We request that you indicate whether or not there's evidence in the record that the stormwater system can handle a 2 or 25-year storm. Last one is the screening. The court has asked whether you make a finding that the parking lot is obscured from Route 77, and as the site plan shows, there'll be one tree every 75 feet. And just the comparison, I know that we, with the hooded and shielded piece on lighting, go back to that one, I believe this board has considered the hooding and shielding to be the fixtures themselves. Certainly, that was a lot of focus on 517 Ocean House's site plan. And so that this idea of having an obstruction would be a different way of interpreting it. And I believe I'm out of my time.
Yeah, you're, if you could wrap it up, thank you, Ms. McGee.
Okay, sentence, and that was as to the screening. 517 Ocean House was required to put in $50,000 worth of plantings, including much more than just the trees along 77, Rosa Rugosa, the planters, the rest of it. And we ask you to consider whether screening is sufficient. Thank you considering the court's remand as the court has asked you to do it. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to be heard from the public regarding this matter? And that being the case, we'll close the public comment period. Maureen, did you wish to add anything yourself on the summary of what's going on on this matter?
I have nothing more to add. I would actually refer to your counsel or directions on questions you have.
Okay. Well, the next, excuse me, time for, I think, the board to discuss this matter. I have discussed with Maureen and with John Wall sort of the most efficient way to handle this, because we do want to be responsive to providing the, to identifying the evidence in the record which persuaded us that these various standards have been met. And there are a lot of different ways to do that. What I'm going to propose, and certainly any member of the board can have a different view and we can discuss it, would be to go down the, I believe there are 16 different paragraphs, beginning on page 6 of the planner's memo, where it's essentially the motion for the board to consider, and just as an example, item 1, the site lighting is or is not adequate for safety. The evidence supporting that finding includes blanks. Get the views of the board from the record that's available to them, which includes all the documents and includes their site walk of the premises and any other information that they consider important. What items would be noted under that particular paragraph to support the finding? I think we will, I'd like to go through each one, make rough notes. Now there are 6 members here and everybody may have a different piece of evidence which is important to them, so we could end up with 3, 4, 5, 6 different things, and I think to craft them into a coherent package this evening might take a huge amount of time. So what I'm going to propose is we go through each one of these, ask your comments, we'll make notes on it, table the matter to the next meeting. In the meantime, this information can be put into coherent English to support the finding, and then it can go back to the court. How does that sound to everybody?
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Well, one thing that I don't have a concern with, but I don't see why we would have to table this if the board as a whole can come to a consensus and see why they find that the criteria is met. I understand for purposes of trying to get something on paper so we can just read it at the next meeting makes sense, but there may be a way to do this without having to send it back and table it for another meeting and get everybody to have to come back next month to do that. So I would like to, if we could, at least attempt to try to do that if possible. And I know there are concerns from the chair about that and respect those, but at the same time, I think that perhaps, and maybe I'm in the minority on this, but we may be able to take care of this tonight.
Well, let's see how it goes. I mean, just on an item, if we have 6 different items, and that's repeated 16 different times, we might be here all night trying to finish it. If everybody lands on 2 or 3 things and we can identify them quickly, so be it. Let's see how it goes. If it works out that way, great, but this is not a rush item, I don't think, but it has to be, I think, drafted with some care so that the court will look at it and, you know, be able to see that its issues have been properly responded. Henry.
Well, if you look at the questions, you go back to the record, and we're talking about what was discussed and the evidence that was presented to mm-hmm. us to make the decision. It's all in this transcript of the meeting. So all we need to, I believe, you need to refer to the page in the paragraph and say that this is the evidence that was presented. It either is good enough or it's not good enough. And it's already written out from what was discussed at the time of the meeting. So I think we could do it by just referring to the page and the paragraph as the evidence to support or not support that question.
Maureen.
I'm looking at counsel while he's walking up to the podium. I'll tell you that particular option was suggested, and it is not recommended by our attorney.
Well, let me put a finer point on it, okay? I think that as a way of shortening, rather than having to restate what appears in a paragraph, you could certainly say I'm referring specifically to this paragraph and the facts that are set forth in here. I believe those facts demonstrate, were proven and demonstrate that it meets this criteria. What I think you really can't do is simply as a wholesale say, this document shows everything we need to show. I think as long as you make specific reference to factual information and say, as a board, we are making a finding that we conclude that this is compelling evidence to support this particular factual issue, that would be sufficient.
So if a board member, sorry, I'm okay to speak?
Henry, we're going to have to go forward on this.
Yeah, I
advocated for something even more simple than what you're suggesting. And
you want something more simple than that?
I tried, but it didn't work. So we're trying to find our way to the Elaine.
John, I have a question about the very helpful memo that we received at this meeting from Maureen, and she has very helpfully consolidated into one place information that comes from various points in the plan. Sometimes it comes from sidewalk, sometimes it comes from discussions that actually happened at a meeting. For our purposes, is this memo part of our record because it's new, or do we really need to take the time to say, gee, Maureen's pulled together a lot of facts on the light on this particular building. I'm persuaded by those facts, but do we also need to reference, and this comes from page 5 of the site plan where we can see it, and it also comes from observations made at the site walk, and it also comes from something in the engineer's report. And if we need to do that more detailed documentation of where all of the points Maureen has made comes from, then I'm skeptical. I'm not prepared to do that tonight because I haven't cross-referenced the various pages of the engineer's report, for example. And if we need that kind of detail to go back to the court, then I guess I'm inclined to agree with Peter's original point that perhaps we can't get there tonight.
Let me say this. I would say that the memo you've received from the planner is an aid to the function you have to do here in terms of dealing with the remand. To the extent the planner has identified elements of the record that the board finds compelling on a particular issue, and that information is summarized in a paragraph, I think it's appropriate for the board to say, I've reviewed this memo, I think it's an accurate summary, I find it's a compelling evidence and it's supported by the record as indicated in this paragraph, and I'm adopting it as the finding to meet this criteria. I think that would be appropriate. But the thing I think you need to make clear is it's the board making the decision. The board has reviewed this. The board has determined that certain facts identified in this memo are, in fact, what you find from the record as supportive of a particular criteria. That's the aspect of it that I think it's important to get across so that both the public and the court is aware that it's the board making the determination as to what facts are supportive of what criteria.
Thank you. I think every board member probably believes that we made a proper decision that night based on the record we had and the criteria and the ordinances. And what we're the task now is to simply describe better for the court on three issues why we made the decision we did. Let me suggest this. Let's just start with number one. People can, many of us may have the same reaction, in which case we only need to say it once. We may have some things that some people were impressed by, others didn't get it, and see what we come up with about four or five. I would love to get it done tonight, as Jonathan suggests. I have some doubts as to whether we can really not only pull it together and describe it coherently in a language that we'd be reasonably proud to present to the court. And so I think if we have to spend the next month just massaging the language and getting it so it reads correctly, it would be time well spent. But let's get a couple of paragraphs under our agenda.
And I'm also fine with erring on the side of caution when it comes to that, too. So don't, please don't think that I'm rushing anybody, but that's sort of my thoughts.
Well, let's shake the tree here and see what falls out in the first couple of items.
Stephen,
yes,
I'm having trouble understanding what people are saying. Is there something wrong with the system, either too loud or it seems to be blending out? Maybe to my hearing, but is anybody else experiencing it, or everybody?
I am, depending who's talking.
Sorry?
I am having a similar issue.
So,
well, let's pull our mics closer to us and make efforts to speak into them. Okay, the paragraph number one, Jonathan, I'm sorry.
I was just noting that I was not leaning back when I was talking, so.
Well, and Carol Ann's mic is so far out of reach, I don't think we'll ever hear from her.
I haven't got anything to say.
Jonathan, thank you.
Okay, paragraph number one, the site lighting is adequate for safety. The evidence supporting that finding includes. Just going around, would you like to bring up things that impress you, Jonathan?
The lighting was something that was specifically addressed by, I believe, myself and Victoria at the hearing, and I believe that the record that we received does support that. Also, looking at the plan itself, I know 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different locations where lights exist. From the sidewalk itself, this was something that was brought up. And one issue that was new to us tonight that counsel for the appellant brought up was this back parking lot that it has no lights. From my recollection and looking at the plan, this back parking lot was not open to the public. This was a back lot that's gravel that was going to be used for employees of the landscaping business itself. On the plan itself, I note that there are two gates that actually, one's a chain gate and the other, I believe, is a steel gate that would limit the public's accessibility to this parking lot. So I don't find that lighting with regards to this back parking lot would be a safety issue for the public.
Thank you. Joe, anything to...
So mine is a little elliptical, but determining whether there's adequate lighting for safety is really, I think, the job of a lighting engineer. And given that this went to the engineer and that they did not really comment on the lighting, that to me says that there was in fact enough lighting and that there's not an unsafe situation being created. I don't think any of us on the board really have the expertise to determine whether the lighting is at a safe level.
Thank you. Henry?
Well, I was looking at the transcript of what actually took part, and there was some discussion in, we asked what time of the year it would be around. In, it said there's parking in the building, and so I asked whether the lighting would be significant, and according to the evidence that was presented, it appeared to be quite significant that it wouldn't be dangerous, because we did ask the applicant, but if somebody got out of their car and would they trip over something? No, it was adequately lit. So I agree with Peter over there that unless you're a lighting engineer, you have to assume that there seemed to be adequate lighting provided.
Elaine?
I agree. I think looking at the location of the fixtures on the plan in relation to the location of the parking and the applicant's description of the relationship of the parking to the various uses of the facility. And also looking specifically, Henry made a comment at the hearing talking about lighting during the winter when it gets dark earlier. And there was a specific reference to that in the record. As Joe said about the engineer's report, basically the way our engineer always responds to our requests is they will generally say that they believe the conditions have been met, and they will point out specific areas where things are not met. And so I think it's appropriate to conclude from that, based on our history with our engineer, that if the engineer does not mention a specific thing as lacking and generally says the application meets the standards, that they have made that technical conclusion. So I think putting those things all together, we have sufficient evidence on the safety of the lighting.
Hey, Caroline.
I'd like to start up by agreeing wholeheartedly with Jonathan's comments. As far as the parking by building number 3, it's not part of public parking. It's for storage or parking of vehicles related to the landscape business. And I agree with what everyone else has said. It's going to be good. Keep me at the end of the line.
Yeah, I would just add for my own part that the sidewalk and the observation of the terrain there and where the parking would be, it's flat, it'll be laid out walkways. There is not a lot of intense lighting, which is fine as long as people will be safe. And my observation of the setting was such that I had no concerns about the safety of the people during hours of darkness.
My question is, as we've just discussed it, could we not take a motion based on the lighting at this particular point? Would we put everything under one motion, or can we just say yes or no to each individual section?
Well, Henry, my own reaction is we have to take these 6 various points and synthesize them into some kind of a coherent statement for the court. And so we're not really in a position, I don't think, and if people disagree,
well,
please speak up.
I was actually Well,
I'm happy to give you my thought on that. I think you should approach it whichever way is going to work best for you. And if you feel as though it's best to get out on the table those facts that you think are pertinent and demonstrate that the criteria has been met, one way of handling it is to get them all on the table. Obviously, the record's being made of that. From that record, you can formulate a proposed set of findings that are complete with regard to all the issues you're being asked to deal with on remand. And then at the next meeting, the motions are made and the votes are taken based upon that synthesis of what's being discussed. Alternatively, if you feel like you have a good enough handle on exactly the language you want to use tonight and you can take a vote, you could do it tonight as well.
Well, we can't do it piecemeal. I mean, we got 16 items we got to get through. But let's handle a couple more and then think about it again, okay?
Because it's a lot to remember if you want to try and come up with suitable wording where we've just discussed it, the suitable wording was already there, if you see what I mean. If you go on for 16 other things, and when you come back to it, you have to refer back to what we've just been talking about.
Well, that's what I'm saying, Henry. If we get through all the 16, it might be really difficult to put one in a coherent motion, if we put it off till the next meeting, and we'll have the language there to vote on.
If that's what you want to do, that's fine.
I have a procedural question. I'm going to make sure John hears it. Just in terms of the rules for tabling, if we begin to vote on findings, can we table it when we're sort of mid-motion?
I don't know the answer.
Is there any reason we couldn't table it if we start taking some votes and then realize we can't finish it?
Well, before John answers, as chair, I would not favor that approach. So that we've got half a motion and come back next week and do the other half.
That's kind of what, if I understand Henry correctly, he was saying, while we have everything right in front of us, why don't we take a vote on finding 1? And so one concern I have is if we take a vote on finding 1 and then we get to finding 8 and realize that one we need to table, can we table in the middle of a motion, which is what we'd kind of be doing?
Partial motion, I guess.
Yeah, just a procedural question.
I think the way the rules work, if there's a motion that's out, it either has to be withdrawn, but it can't, you can't interrupt it in the middle. It has to be resolved at the meeting.
Okay, that's what I was thinking.
But there's no reason in this, like, if you're dealing with this, each of these items separately, if you are able to address six of these, but don't get to the last six or seven or however many it is. I think as long as the motion is voted on, a motion is made, the motion is voted on at a meeting, that's fine. Even if though it's within a, you know, a schedule of other motions that you intend to get to but don't get to, there's no reason why you can't table the rest of those issues, the rest of those motions for a later time.
The rest of the motions on this same matter we could do later.
As, right. In other words, you can't leave the meeting with a motion pending. So as long as all the motions that are proposed are voted on and resolved at a meeting, to the extent there are other issues that you still need to address that you don't get to, don't have a motion on, you can deal with those at the next meeting.
Great. Thank you.
Great.
I'd just like to point out, you haven't made a motion.
I know. No, we haven't, but what Henry was talking about would require one.
Well, and I think Henry was saying, let's do each one as we go along and somehow remember what they were and vote the whole thing. Henry, I hear you. But I think we would end up with a real can of worms. And I would rather go through this thing and then come back with a coherent response to each item.
With all due respect, I think if we go the other route, then you have to write everything down at a separate thing and then vote on it in another meeting.
Exactly. That's what
we're now referring back to these when it's not fresh. But it doesn't matter. It all end up at the same point. So. Maybe I'd like to poll the other members and see what they feel. And
then other members have a sense of how we should proceed? Caroline?
I think we should not do these one at a time. If we're talking about lighting, we should look at all the lighting pieces. We should look at all the landscaping pieces. We should look at all the stormwater pieces. If after we get through these groupings, we want to make a finding on that particular item, that makes more sense than doing them one at a time. I think we just need to pick a path and go on it, or else we'll still be discussing how we're going to do it in an hour.
And we have a lot of items on the agenda. Other people from the town have business to conduct, and I would like to get through this with a little bit of substance in each one for Maureen and myself to synthesize, and at the next meeting come back and call for a vote from A to Z. Anybody?
Yeah, I agree with that. I think blast through these, and
I think that's what we're going to have to do.
Okay.
And we could do quick consensus, but like on the first one, it seemed like we reached a consensus pretty quickly.
Yeah, and that one is a fairly easy one. But even so, there were four or five different points that all have to be expressed.
Yeah. And I agree with what Carol Ann states that, I mean, the first three have to do with lighting.
Yep.
And then the next two have to do with landscaping, and then so on with stormwater. So maybe we could group those together so we're not making the same points on each. Obviously, they specify different things.
Well, no, they are organized by subject matter, Caroline, and so if we do one, two, and three, we've been lighting. Four, five, six, and so on gets the other stuff. Okay, let's take a whack at number two. There will not be excessive illumination based on the fixtures shown in the application, fixtures observed during the sidewalk, the distance of fixtures from the property lines, and the downward lighting fixtures closest to the property lines. The evidence supports that finding includes, want to go from stage left to stage right again?
From what I remember from the site walk and the plans that I'm looking at, that there's going to be on the property lines buffers, I think a stockade fence on the north side facing the Ledoux property, and there's already existing buffers on the Pillsbury property, and then a stockade fence going up to the Chapman property. So, and then on the back, there's not even going to be any lighting on that side where there is no public parking. The other lighting that is on the plan and that we saw during the site walk, I think that it's going to be, it's not going to be excessive for the abutter. So I was satisfied with what I saw.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah. One piece of evidence, historically, there was no complaints on the existing lighting. The lights all seemed sufficiently far back from the property lines to me during the sidewalk. The lights are all adjustable. They can be angled down as required.
Thank you. Henry?
Well, as I saw it, it's a landscaping site, and it seems to blend quite well in with the existing architecture around it, which is trees and shrubbery, and not being my expertise field, but it looked pretty natural to me, and I didn't see anything that would be disturbing or aesthetically unpleasing. So for me, it met all the requirements.
Thank you. Elaine?
I would just add that there was some significant discussion at the meeting about the requirement of a photometric study, which would have given specific measures of illumination. And I believe that the planning board appropriately concluded that under the circumstances, it was appropriate to waive that requirement. And I think I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah, and that was not mentioned by the court under the topic of lighting. Caroline?
Yeah, I believe that my recollection on the sidewalk is similar to Jonathan's, in that we looked very closely at the existing lighting, and there was no new lighting being proposed. So, and on the absence of complaints, we felt that it was satisfactory.
Yeah, I agree and have nothing to add. Okay, paragraph three, the lighting will be adequately shielded by existing buildings, existing and proposed fencing, existing and proposed plantings. The evidence supporting that finding includes, Jonathan?
I'm going to note what I said on number two.
Okay.
I don't want to repeat myself.
Same as number two, Joe?
Same as two.
Henry?
It looked okay to me.
I would want to refer to the summary that Maureen gave to us of the lights on the various buildings and the locations where either trees or fencings or buildings themselves would provide shielding. And actually, I suppose this also applies to point number two. And comparing the summary that Maureen prepared for us with the actual information that we can see on the plan and the report of the engineer that we have, plus the observations that other planning board members made at the site walk, I think each one of those detailed lights that are called out there, I think that summary reflects correctly the totality of the record that we have on this point, and that also applies to number two.
Caroline?
Just going to say ditto.
Okay, very good. That's items one through three on lighting. We move next to the issues of landscaping. Item four, the landscaping around and within parking lots, including the lawn areas, maple trees, half barrels, ornamental grasses, and sign planters, do soften the hard surface of parking areas. Evidence supporting that finding includes, Jonathan?
Yeah, from what we saw on the sidewalk and then looking at the plans also, I mean, there's references to planting trees that there's already, I believe that there were going to be, I can't find it here, or the landscape plan that specifically referenced, excuse me, it goes to granite boulders that would be used to obscure the parking lot, half barrels of ornamental grass, counts three maple trees that were going to be planted. There's going to be mulch and perennials, granite slabs. So overall, I think that the applicant did do an adequate job that I'm satisfied with regards to softening the site of the parking area.
Thank you. And Joe?
Yeah, I mean, they replaced a fair amount of asphalt with lawn, which I think goes a long way to soften that whole front.
Thank you. Henry?
Yeah, the site's rural. I mean, 77 where this site is a rural area. There's lots of greenery around. I mean, this is a, yet again, a landscaping company with plantings going on all over the place, seedlings. It looks very rural as well. I think it adequately was protected and looked, and appears to look that it fits in with the surroundings.
Thank you, Henry. Elaine?
I would just agree with what's been said previously.
Okay. Caroline?
Yes, I think the, trying to think how to phrase what I want to say. I think the fact that a lot, that front parking lot is being replaced by lawn goes a long way to improving the look of the site. And the way that the walk is going through and is kind of meandering through the site. And I mean, there's nothing, I'm not saying that you won't be able to see there are cars parked there, but there's going to be enough of a buffer to soften the look of cars parked in the parking lot. I mean, there is no, I haven't seen any parking lot that's on the front or side of the building in this town where you cannot see the cars. There's just something to delineate the parking and to try to soften the view. So I thought it was an adequate job.
And I would support what Caroline just said. I mean, it's a little bit ironic here. We have a landscaping company which is doing this, and there's a quite a robust landscaping plan, reduction of a lot of the hard topping and replacing with lawn and plantings. And I think what is will result from, as shown in the plan, will be something that's entirely consistent with what we have elsewhere in the town on the softening and shielding of parking areas from the public view. So I'm quite satisfied with it. Item five, landscaped area is located between the road and the parking lot and includes plantings that sufficiently obscure the view of parked cars and parking lots. I suspect we may be repeating ourselves on this one, but Jonathan?
That's yes, what I've said on number four.
Joe?
Yeah, same as four.
Henry?
I pass along that part of the road almost every day. There are other buildings there that nowhere near meet the type of plating that this site does. So this is more than adequate by comparison to anything else, and obviously goes in with the surrounding area.
Elaine?
I would specifically note on this one the esplanade and street trees that are going to be along the front of the property, and the plantings that are kind of at the edges of the property, property boundaries, so that as you're coming down the road, I think there is adequate landscaping, both existing and proposed, to buffer the view of the parking lot, in addition to the fact that the parking areas that were the most stark looking from the road or are at under the present conditions, those are no longer going to be there at all but are going to have green space. And I think that although grass doesn't actually obscure cars, I think it softens the view, and combined with the other plantings that do provide some obscuring, this plan is quite sufficient and very much in keeping with the idea of the BA zone.
Thank you. Caroline?
What I said before.
Okay. Moving along.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
So number two just asks us to find whether the plantings between the road and parking area will obscure the view of parked cars. Do we really need to talk about softening the hard surface? Do you think that's going to...
This work was, I think, a collaboration of John and Maureen. And John, can you explain why these items are included?
I think probably both of them were included because they're both part of the same subsection. You're correct that the court really only mentioned the obscuring the parked cars from the road. I don't think there's any harm in making the additional finding, but the reality is that it's really the obscuring issue that was the only one that the court sent back.
All right, yeah, I just, and everybody feels like we addressed the obscuring issue sufficiently.
Elaine?
Sorry?
No, Elaine has her hand up.
I think we have, and I think one of the questions that it's appropriate for us to look at is what does the word obscure mean in our ordinance? And I think part of obscuring the view of parked cars is the image of landscaping that one has when looking at the parking lot. So to me, the softening, the fact of softening, also bolsters a conclusion that the view is obscured because what the eye focuses on when looking at the property is not cars, but the eye will be focusing on landscaping. And to me, that softening is part of obscuring, as our ordinance is meant to be interpreted.
I might add, as you drive along Route 77, I think if you look at Ms. McGahey's client's restaurant, you see cars. The cars are not hidden behind some massive wall of forestry. The idea is to soften the edges, make it blend in, make it, I think Elaine's word, stark, which is what it is right now, is probably a very good word, and it will no longer be stark. It will be nicely landscaped and attractive. Are we okay, Joe?
Yeah.
Everybody good on that? Okay. Item number six, the planning board waives, as provided in section 18.2.7, the filing of pre- and post-stormwater calculations and any other information not provided by the applicant. The evidence supporting that includes... Jonathan?
I would reference the letter dated April 30th, 2015 from Northeast Civil Solutions with regards to stormwater. I believe it's page 4. It makes a specific finding that they do an analysis based upon the topographical survey and analyzing the current and proposed drainage patterns. Basically, because of the no changes in the drainage patterns, no proposed increases in the building footprints, and minimum changes in the parking layout, that there would be a request to the waiver of the pre- and post-developmental stormwater study. From what we saw on the site walk and knowing this property, it was the old Agway hardware store before, I believe, the Tamaros bought it. They're going to also get rid of a large portion of asphalt, which I think will... increase the amount of grass and reduce the amount of impervious surface area. So I was okay with the, I was in agreement with the waiving the requirement for the stormwater calculations.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would just add the town engineer recommended it in reviewing the proposal.
Henry?
Okay. Agree. I think they're taking a building away, which reduces the impervious area in, as they say, as a gas belt being reduced. So it isn't a problem now. I can't conceive it would be a problem when you're adding more area to absorb water.
Elaine?
I would add to that that when we look at the number of things that the town engineer did ask to be modified on the plans, the town engineer requested a number of minor variations in the way that water was handled on the property and supported waiving this requirement for pre- and post calculations. So I believe that there was adequate basis for concluding that the town engineer made the technical conclusion that that information was not necessary to do the analysis that the statute required. And I think based on a completely lay view of it, it looks like the facts are there, but I would rely very heavily on what the town engineer concluded.
Caroline?
As far as the stormwater goes, I rely heavily on the town engineer's I always rely heavily on the town engineer comments, and I believe he supported he and Public Works Director in another instance supported the changes that were proposed and the fact that we don't need pre and post, that it's an improvement.
My observation from the plans and the site walk is essentially a flat property. There's substantial stormwater drainage in the street front part of the property, catch basins and underground water transport. There is, we're aware of no history of flooding in the property, and when they're reducing the impervious surface by some 15% or more and taking down some buildings, it strikes me as a classic case where you would grant a waiver of this type. Okay, number, any others? We go to that one. Number seven, the planning board finds that the basic site data provided is adequate to make a determination of compliance with section 1995D stormwater management. The evidence supporting that finding includes, Jonathan?
Just echoing what I said on number six, and also just adding that, that the town engineer would supporting this, that it's in compliance with 1995.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, same as six.
Henry?
Can I say ditto?
Elaine?
Yes, I think the town engineer's conclusions support that.
Caroline?
Yeah, town engineer's letter dated May 12, 2015, paragraph number four, totally supports this change with a couple minor tweaks that he recommended.
I'd just like to sort of state for the record that I don't think anybody here is saying that we've delegated our decision to the town engineer. I think what we're saying is that we're finding the town engineer's recommendations we regard as important in making our own finding that the stormwater waiver is granted.
I'd just like to say the town engineer is an engineer. I am not. I rely heavily on his statements when it comes to certain practices, and this is one of them.
Thank you. Number eight, the planning board does reduce or waive any requirements of the ordinance because the basic site data furnished under section 18.2.6a that the estimated cost of construction and long-term maintenance resulting from compliance with the design requirements in any instance clearly outweigh the downstream benefits to be achieved by compliance. You'll recognize that language right out of the ordinance. The evidence supporting that finding includes?
From what I recall and looking back at the record and reviewing it is that given the fact that there's actually not going to be the construction versus the they're actually taking away pavement and not increasing any building footprint. I think that we would be able to waive any requirements under 18.2.6.
Thank you, Joe.
I didn't really understand this.
Could the authors of that paragraph, authors of that paragraph explain exactly what you're driving
you
at?
You can draw me some pictures.
Can I help?
Yeah.
Okay, so section 18 is the stormwater provisions. And I'm just going to remind you of all the quality time we spent with the technical amendments. It's the same sections of stormwater. And the current site plan regulations state that if you have a site with more than 10,000, I believe, square feet of impervious surface, you are supposed to use the stormwater standards in Chapter 18. However, just like the site plan regulations allow waivering of submission requirements, the stormwater ordinance is actually much more generous. It allows you to waive not just submission requirements, but it also allows you to waive standards if you can find that, for example, the cost of construction and the long-term maintenance is outweighed by what you would have to spend to generate that information.
Okay. So how does this differ from the town engineer recommending?
The town engineer uses Chapter 18 in making his recommendations to the planning board.
It's essentially a cost-benefit type of statement, isn't it?
It's one of the things, yeah.
Waiver can be granted if it appears that they...
You know, under site plan review, under subdivision review, you can waive submission requirements. Under the stormwater ordinance, Chapter 18, you can waive not just submission requirements, you can even waive standards. But for example, making a finding that generating pre and post calculations is something that an applicant could do. An applicant could then say, I'm asking for a waiver because the cost of generating those is, you would make a decision whether or not that was something you thought was important.
Does that cover it, Joe?
Yeah, I'm gonna...
Any comments?
Go on.
Okay, Henry?
No, I just noted that around the site, it's fairly natural, nothing's been changed in, not in the site, but around the site, periphery, in that as you're reducing the impervious area, it would seem pointless to try and put in some stormwater system that would give you no advantage over what you've currently got.
Thank you, Elaine.
Yes, I would also say that if you look at the town engineer's letter talking about the flow of water on the property and its impact, talking different culverts that are needed, changes to the piping, that the town engineer was clearly looking at downstream effects and did not apparently need any additional data to be provided or any additional work to be done in order to conclude that the off-site impact of the stormwater on this property was being adequately dealt with, which I think relates to the somewhat obscure language that we have in point 8 here. I think the basic idea is we have all the information in the record that we need on stormwater to conclude that the stormwater requirements in our site plan ordinance, as supplemented by the stormwater requirements in the stormwater ordinance, as they may be altered based on this kind of practicality cost-benefit analysis, do we have enough information in the record to conclude that those requirements are met? And I think looking at the information submitted by Northeast Civil Solutions, the information from Stephen Harding, our town engineer, and then the response by Northeast Civil Solutions demonstrates that adequate information is in the record to support those stormwater findings and to require the necessary modifications and adjustments of the plan, which were included in our approval to meet those requirements.
Thank you. Caroline?
Okay, I'm going to take a stab at my interpretation. So my understanding is, or way I see this, is the applicant's plan, existing plan to improve the drainage or stormwater handling in this site is adequate it's going to be an improvement, and therefore, why do we need to study the stormwater to figure out if he needs to improve it? Because he's already going to improve it. So that's the way I interpreted it. So I say a reduction or waiver of that requirement.
Thank you.
Peter, just to echo on what Elaine said, I think looking at we can go through these one by one, but the remaining paragraphs all have to do with stormwater. And so I just would hate to have us, we can do it, but.
Well, I think we ought to finish the way we started. I think we can certainly streamline our commentary in these things, and I think making reference back to the points made previously will be fine, and then I really would urge the board to accept the idea of letting Maureen and I, with some vetting by John, synthesize mm-hmm. these comments into a coherent package of a resolution. Okay, nine, based on information provided in existing conditions of the site and reduction of impervious surface, adequate provisions will be made for the collection and disposal of stormwater. And I think it's, John, unless you disagree, making reference to the points previously made at this stage of the game is okay.
I was just going to say, I think the whole idea of having these separately identified is just so that you are aware that there are various criteria under the stormwater management provision, each of which should be considered and articulated as part of whatever vote you're going to take. But as John indicated, most of these, the same kind of information would inform each of these criteria, so indicating that, you know, the issue in 9, 10, 11, or whatever, right, are all demonstrated by, and then stating what that fact would be, I think is sufficient, so it'll allow us to synthesize something.
Oh, good. And there's a cluster of evidence in the record on this point generally and applied specifically, so if we can just zip through these. But I would like to at least be able to say for the record that we've considered each issue. So on number 9 is a reference to the previous discussion. Acceptable? Any new points? Let's say new points only. Henry, you had a new point?
No.
Okay.
I have nothing new to add.
All righty. Number 10.
Peter, can I ask
a
question? I'm not sure to what extent we've actually referenced the various plans, and I think they do add additional support. They show some drainage, they show piping, so I think there is detail on the plans.
Oh, absolutely. I thought that had been mentioned. Yeah, there's extensive, you know, drainage and whatnot stuff in the plans themselves, which is...
It's not just the information of the two engineers. It is supported by the graphics on the plans.
No, I
cross-reference
totally
to the plan.
Well,
on all of these.
In these things, we'll make reference to the plan, even by sheet number, if you'd like. Okay, that was 9. 10, conversion of paved and other impervious surfaces to loamed and seeded lawn area will result in retaining...
No, will not result.
Retaining stormwater using
natural features.
Will result in retaining stormwater using natural features. Yeah? That's a positive statement. Anything to add?
Nothing additional to add.
Joe, anybody? Just raise your hand if you have something new. Elaine?
I would just call out on this one the additional front yard planting that is being proposed here, reducing the existing paving, I think is particularly relevant to number 10.
Okay. The reduction in impervious area will detain and retain water on the site at a rate below pre-development of the proposed site plan. Anything new over what we've discussed?
Will not detain.
Will not.
Below or above?
Will detain and retain at a rate below.
What do you mean?
At a rate below pre-development, don't you mean?
Because it is no longer impervious, the water will be soaking into the ground and will not be retained.
The retention will be increased on the property because there's more pervious. Anyway, we'll sort that out.
It's two questions. Detain and retain is opposite to one another. It is not going to retain it, but
it's going to retain.
What?
It's not going to run off.
Yeah, it's going to capture it and absorb it.
And reduce runoff.
My only question is the word below, and I think maybe a different word might be selected. It'll be improved or enhanced by the reduction of impervious surface. Okay, moving on, number 12, on and off-site downstream channels will have sufficient capacity to carry flow without adverse effects. And we think we have a number of engineering analyses on that point. If anybody else has anything new to add. 13, the closure of the existing drainage way adjacent to the new path is specifically approved. That is shown on the plans. I'm not sure why we're calling it out in this level of detail, John, unless you...
Is it
Why are we calling that particular point out on this level of detail on number 13?
Get Maureen.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, Maureen. You were hiding behind me.
These are the standards in chapter 18.
Yeah.
That you get kicked into when you have a site with more than 10,000 square feet. These are the things that the town engineer bases his recommendations on to you.
No, I understand that, but it was there anything in...
And there is a specific thing that talks about closing in drainage wells.
No, I understand that too, but was the, okay, so you think that all follows from the issue the court left us with on...
No, you get kicked into chapter 18.
Yeah, all right.
Peter, one of the things that I recall that we, was discussed on the site walk with regards to this was that area closer to the road, I believe that they were going to redesign for the stormwater, and it's actually shown on the plans also, so...
Well, they have new catch basins, and I think there's a bigger diameter underground passage, and it's...
Yes.
There's a lot of stuff in there about that. Other new comments or items? Elaine?
Well, the town engineer specifically talks about drainage relating to the new path, which I think supports the finding that whatever alteration may have happened there is appropriate and, in fact, will improve the property drainage and increase the, slow down the speed and rate of the percolation of the water.
Okay. 14, the stormwater design will not damage streets, adjacent properties, excuse me, downstream properties, soils or vegetation. In addition to the, any other new items in addition to the package of the stuff we've talked about?
Nothing new.
Okay, 15, the stormwater design does not impede upstream stormwater flows. Okay, we got the downstream and the upstream. Same?
No, I think it enhances the percolation on the property, which would assist with that.
Okay. And last but not least, 16, the biological and chemical properties of the receiving waters will not be degraded by the stormwater runoff from the development site. And
nothing additional.
Same engineering and whatnot, okay?
Same thing on percolation, I think, is important here, that by increasing the, by reducing the impervious surface, we're actually improving the water treatment, the natural water treatment on the site.
And John may not agree with this, but it seems to me that we could probably array 7 or 8 bullet points synthesizing all the engineering advice and the site plan and the review of the plans themselves, and that body of information is probably responsive to the last 5 items by reference.
And that's what I want to make sure that the board articulates, so it's clear that when these last few items that we've been dealing with pertaining to stormwater management, there were a number of items that were discussed at the outset concerning the first or second of these criteria that were mentioned, and then you've said, I have nothing more to add. What you're referring to is back to that group of material. Is that clear from the board's perspective? Okay.
Yes.
So yes, I agree. When you're synthesizing that, because that's the consensus, that's what you can,
okay,
the way you can approach it.
So I think we've covered this. I'm going to recommend to the board that trying to repackage this tonight would keep us here until very late hours and be unfair to everybody else who has business before the board. And so I would like to entertain a motion to table this to the next meeting of the planning board, in which time Maureen and I have John vet it. We'll try to create some coherent language for each one of these 16 items that we can then pass as a completely as a motion and submit to the court. Do I have such a motion to table this?
I have a motion to table the 517 Ocean House LLC versus Town of Cape Elizabeth item to the
July third Tuesday of the month meeting. Whose date I?
We'll fill it in. Do we have a second?
The July planning board meeting. How about that?
Yes. There you go.
Thank you.
Do we have a second for that motion? Elaine, thank you. Any discussion on the second motion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. John, thank you very much for coming. Appreciate it. Okay. Next item of business is the Wentworth Lodge Special Event Facility. Sprague Corporation is requesting site plan review of a proposed special event facility located at 10 Winters Lane, and this is the site plan public hearing under section 19-9. We will do the following. We'll ask the applicant to summarize changes made to the plan since the last meeting. The board will then hold the public hearing. At the close of the public hearing, the board will begin discussion. And at the end of the discussion, the board may approve the conditions, table, or deny the application. Okay, John, thank you. If you could identify yourself for the record and describe to us any changes made since the last meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is John Green, property manager for Sprague Corporation. We have comments to make regarding, or changes to make regarding comments from the last meeting of May 17th. The only thing I might need to know here is how to slide this back and forth, Maureen. Trying to get over to the notes section, just where some of the changes occurred. Hold down. There we go.
Just use two fingers.
Okay. Gotcha. Thank you.
It's sad now. So two fingers.
Yes, thank you. As I mentioned, there were comments made by planning board members last meeting, May 17th. The first item was they were asked to add a deed reference to item two, the notes, and that was done on the upper right-hand corner here. The second item was a change to the wording for the shoreline overlay district from mean high to normal high water line. Item three was a change to note 10 to reflect how the normal high water line was calculated. And I'll get to another letter regarding that a little later in this these bullet points. Number four was to add note 12 to include the type of events expected. And I don't know if you can see that, if I can. Item 12, oops, here we go. We're turning it blue again. Not a Mac guy, so it's
use two fingers.
Not working, Maureen. Sorry about that. That's there. Yeah, maybe we can try it this way. One last try here. Oh, sorry, my fingers aren't working. Sorry about that. Item, let's see, where was I here? It was number four. We added note 12 to include the types of events expected at the site, and we also included in note 12 the requirements of the ordinance, just so they're reiterated in note number 12. Number five is that we fix, not note five, item five is that we fix several typos mentioned throughout the plan. Hope we didn't miss any there. Number six, we reviewed the fire chief's comments per an email to Maureen on June 13th regarding the fire lanes being maintained at 20 feet during the event. So we will either can add a note to accommodate that, or the lanes are indeed marked out at 20 feet. And I believe the fire chief had no problem with that as long as they remained open. Item 7 is in Maureen's approval conditions. Later in this memo to the planning board, we have taken note of those. I have sent those changes to the notes to our to BH2M to have those added to the plan unless there are other changes. So those items can and will be added to the plan. Wanted to note that to the board. Item 8, a letter from BH2M was drafted for me today. I will hand it out to the board. It's regarding the normal high water line and how it ended up the way it was. I'll hand those out to the board. I have 14 copies, but I'll hand out the copies of those right now, just so you have them.
Thank you.
And to sort of summarize, I'll let you read that if you like, to summarize the prior plan, our 1999 land use plan. Apparently, according to BH2M, there was a typo, and it was listed as NGVD 1988. It was supposed to be North American vertical datum 1988. And so that is the basis for that. Datum was, in fact, NAVD 1988. The 9.1 elevation, since there are only 2-foot contours provided in our 1999 land use plan, and I believe that's continued today for a requirement as 2-foot contours, there has to be an approximation done by computer through the CAD program to approximate the 9.1 elevation at that time. So, given the same data being used, the same plat, the 9.6 elevation is also an approximation given the 2-foot contours from 9 to 10. So they use the CAD program to approximate the 9.6 and then run the 250-foot buffer from that point. Given the location of this event facility location here, the contours on the shore are, there is a drop off there. They run from 2 to 28 feet within a very short distance, so they're all essentially piled on top of one another. So finding the 9.6 elevation can be done, but on the actual site plan, there are many locations where there's 10 contours where there's a more or less a cliff. So that's why you're seeing that heavy line run through the plan, sort of muddles the other contours. And we are happy to have, if need be, our engineer come out and surveyor and explain all that, should it be required. After reading the letter here, if there are questions, that can be accommodated if needed. So those are the items there, except for one more here is the planning board members did attend a site walk on May 24th. And I think other than doing the site walk, the only note was that it was noted we should place restriction on the bathroom use at Wentworth Lodge. And that is done anyway by Mrs. Sprague because, as I mentioned, the consequences of doing otherwise would be drastic, and the septic system would fail, and it would be a huge expense. We've had many events at that site and have had no problems because that's been a standard of hers all along. That's all I have at the moment. Are there any questions?
Any questions from the board?
You said
20-foot fire lane, that's where you're saying 20-foot typical in the parking lot? That's a 20-foot fire lane?
It's not a fire lane. The lanes to delineate between the parking spaces is set at 20 feet. So you'll see there is one on the...
You mentioned a fire lane?
I'm sorry, what I meant was the fire chief was saying that he would prefer that those lanes in the parking lot remain open during the event. They're technically not fire lanes, but he wanted them to remain open for emergency vehicles. I believe there's three lanes there. The first one is on the right-hand side of the lot, one in the middle, and then one on the left side.
So you might want to just change that note from 20-foot typical to 20-foot minimum typical? Just add the word minimum in there.
We can do that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Victoria.
I did have some questions, and I was kind of hoping your engineer would be here tonight based on the questions that I did have from the last meeting. And I'm trying to quickly bring myself up to speed on the information in this letter. I wish it had come.
I would, too. I was away on vacation, et cetera. No excuses, but it happened to arrive late today.
So I also agreed, I picked up on the error that they made back in, was this made in 1998? I picked up on the error that they used the wrong NGVD, should have been.
Correct.
I picked up on that also.
Yes, I figured that's when I read this, I realized that was the case, and the approval was in 99, but the work was done in 1988.
And so,
I'm sorry, 98.
98. So when I picked up on that error, that kind of, you know, brings me right back to, because they also say, we assume the intent was, once again, the qualifying language, because this is the problem, John, and I wish your engineers were here. So I'm going to have to address these problems to you, even though I know.
I get that, yes, I understand that. I read the same letter, and I saw the same things.
When I put this plan together with the plan from 1998, they're the same plan. The engineers took the same plan, and they added the tent area, the parking area. They added so they could make.
Correct, yes.
But it's the same exact. So when I compared the two, so this, when I say the same exact, I mean right down to the shrubbery, you know, all this puffy, everything is exactly the same. Nothing's changed except for the things added for the facility. So when I look at the 250-foot shoreline performance overlay district, this is my concern. It's exactly the same. You could overlay the two, and they are, because you can see it based on all the puffy, nothing has changed. And that concerns me because, as you know, we spent so much time making changes.
Right.
And so that is my biggest concern. So these are the questions I would like to ask. And I'm going to have to direct them to you, John. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. And the only comment I might make quickly is the 9.1 used back then versus the 9.6. And given the cliff face where these contours are mashed together, you're not going to have too much change in this location, if any. I mean, it would be minuscule. But I'm happy to have you ask all those questions. I will have to relay them to our surveyor.
Yeah, I really wish they'd been here based
upon
the conversation
absolutely.
That we had. Okay. First, has the normal high water line plus 3 feet been field verified?
It has not been field. It's been done through a CAD program, given the photometric data from 1998.
The photometric method, is that LIDAR?
No, LIDAR is a whole different thing, light ranging.
So this line then is based on, and this is, I got off of the original map, it's using aerial photometric methods.
Correct.
And this board had learned a lot about LIDAR how accurate LIDAR is and.
Right, I looked that up. LIDAR, a common myth. Does LiDAR replace traditional mapping methods? LiDAR is a complement to, not a replacement for, traditional aerial mapping methodologies. For most uses, LiDAR intensity imagery is not a viable replacement for aerial photography, nor does LiDAR data provide an option for planimetric mapping. And some of the LiDAR data used in your, I think it was the Slavinsky report, although data is quite accurate, the data should not be, should only be used for planning purposes only. So LiDAR is, can be very accurate, but it is not used for the mapping. And given the open area of that spot, it's as accurate. So what I'm saying is there's some misconceptions about LiDAR.
I actually agree with what you're saying, because I went back and I looked at Pete Slavinsky's report, just to refresh my memory.
Yes.
We were all there, so...
Yes, I remember. I attended several meetings.
And there actually was some pictures of the Scarborough Marsh and how they did a LiDAR, but then they showed them going down into the field to field verify the LiDAR. So that goes back to my first question. Was the photometric in this case, because you're saying they didn't use LiDAR, was the photometric field surveyed, and you already said no?
Well, it was field surveyed at the time.
Not, was it?
Not at this time, but I will verify that with the... yes.
Okay, because I thought you just...
Oh, no, I was referring question. To... we did not go out and field verify again, is what I was trying to say. I thought you were referencing okay. us going out again.
No. But you're saying, yes, this was field verified.
I believe there was some field verification because they put out, I forget what they call that, the aerial markers, let's say, yes, at certain locations, yes.
Okay.
And that will be verified. Just to make sure here, I want to make sure that...
Well, that was one of my questions to the engineers, so I appreciate it.
Victoria, could I ask you where you're going with this?
The point of this...
Because there are no permanent structures and whatnot that will be done. I realize you're saying that you question the accuracy of the delineations, and there are no structures that are, permanent structures being erected here. Is this material to the application?
If, as the whole board knows, I'm all about details and accuracy. So I am questioning the 250 foot. How does that go to what we're looking at tonight? Is it's then, if you have your 250 foot buffer plotted out, then that's where you come up with your 75 foot shoreline setback. And I agree that you cannot have things in the 75 foot shoreline. And so how do I know that number is accurate? Is I have to feel 100% confident that the 250-foot number is accurate, which I don't.
But are you objecting to the possibility that there be a temporary tent that might encroach into the area that you think is in question?
Can a temporary tent, Maureen, be in the 75-foot? It can? Okay. I am just questioning whether or not that line is correct. And so it just sets the tone for, I don't really know where the 75 would fall. I don't know if it's minuscule. I mean, it's just, these are the questions I have because of the 75 foot is our most important. But we did receive, I do have other questions, but maybe I'll just jump at this point. We did receive an email from Maureen in a conversation that you had with the code enforcement officer. If maybe you could explain a little bit about the questions that the code enforcement officer had around.
The only question he had was regarding the ratio of porta potties to attendees. On the shoreline zoning, I think there would be a lot more concern about getting this more precise if there were any permanent structures proposed.
Okay.
And, you asked, does this apply to temporary tents? Well, I suppose if you were going to pour concrete footings for the base of a tent, then you would have to comply with the setback. But if all it is something that's temporary, that's not a structure, it doesn't meet the structure definition, then it's not going to need the 75-foot setback. And I think that's where we're kind of getting stuck, is there's just nothing here that's really triggering the 75 feet. So I'm going to go back to the porta potties. That's a lot easier. actually, the code officer asked him to look at that, and he used the plumbing code, and there's different standards for different situations and different genders. And after reviewing all of those standards, the conclusion he came to that a one porta potty for every 40 attendees was probably a better standard. And that was the one thing he did forward with. But on the shoreline zoning, you know, to be honest, if you have a vertical face and your normal high water line is here, and you, or it's right here, and then you have to go up 3 vertical feet, it's still going to be in the same spot. So that would be a rationale for the line looking like it's in the same place.
Okay. It's my eyes, it's in the exact same. So I did have those questions, but if the code enforcement officer is not going to be viewing any of this as permanent, I can throw it over to Carolyn at this point.
I just want to mention, on the sidewalk, it was this area, the shoreline here, it is very cliffy. It is not a shallow grade out into the ocean. It is up in a pretty sheer face. So it does fall into that category. Things are going to be pretty tight together. So, the difference could be minuscule. Just to give you an observation from having gone on the sidewalk.
You can see on the map that it's very close to the elevation line.
Peter? Yes, Lane.
Following up on what Victoria was saying, if there is some question about the exact location of that shoreline line, and if it is significant that the proposed tent is a temporary tent and not a structure, would it be appropriate to note on the plan, as well as anywhere else that it might appear in the application, that this proposal is not approving any permanent structures, and that the tent is to be a temporary tent only? I'm not sure how exactly you define what's temporary, what's permanent, but I'm wondering if that should be indicated on the plan specifically, because we're not precisely clear where that shoreline line might be.
Peter?
John?
I agree that we appreciate your attention to detail on this, Victoria, but my concern is less because it's my understanding from the site walk and from the presentation by the applicant that the people who basically rent this property for a wedding are going to be bringing in their own tents and setting up and breaking down, and that's it. I like the idea of possibly putting something in there that says it would not be permanent. However, I think that is taken care of by the idea that the event shall not exceed 8 hours in duration, excluding setup and breakdown. So to me, that it's sort of implied that there's going to be a setup and a breakdown as part of each event, and there's only 12 events that are allowed. So this, I think we would be protected as a board from the applicant sort of having a tent that's up there all summer, and then the 12 events that are held there, and also from the representations made by the applicant that it's up to the people who are bringing or that renting out the property that they're going to bring in their own tents and break it up.
Maybe we could just add to the note you already referred to that the setup and breakdown would include the installation and removal of any tent. Just put that in the note, because to me, it's not obvious looking at this plan that the tent would have to be taken down each time, but that the tent could be semi-permanent, could stay up for the entire season. And if that's not what we intend, I think we should say it.
Julia.
Seb, isn't that's already in the definition of a special event facility? I mean, I don't think we need to recreate every provision that's already in the ordinance.
Maybe, could you tell me how is that in there?
I'd have to look, but I'm just guessing that the special event overlay district does not include permanent structures.
Actually, if they're presented to the board, they can include permanent structures.
As part of the site plan, you could have a permanent structure built in.
I think
what Elaine's proposing is a very simple request in the wording, just including tents. Certainly willing to support that.
Very reasonable compromise.
Yeah, in the interest of moving this along, Elaine, could you provide some lingo that we might plug in?
Maureen just gave me some that Carol Ann can read there.
You want me to read for you?
Yeah.
Here's an idea for a condition, that a note be added to the plan that no permanent structures are proposed or included in this application. This approval assumes that tents to be installed for events are temporary and will need to be removed after events. So there's a condition.
There, we're not, the question is, let's assume you had two events, one after the other. Why would you want to break down the tent after the event and then put it back up again a couple of days later? Tents by nature are temporary, I assume. So I guess the question I'm asking is, why are we going to that extent?
I said events. Events.
Well, if there's two events, one following on the other.
With the same tent vendor.
Well, with the same tent, obviously, yes.
I'm suggesting that for the purposes of that condition, we can consider like a program of events for one family over weekend. They wouldn't be required to take down the tent on Friday night and then put it back up on Saturday.
I think we could cope with that one. Victoria, does that cover your range of issues? Because I would like to get this thing up for a vote so we can go on to other business if there's nothing.
Yeah, that was my largest concern is, I picked up on your typo, which brings me back to, I don't even know if the original data was correct, which, you know, is this data, but anyways, why don't we move on, and I do want to see something of what Elaine said, because I was thinking if something like another special event facility, it does occur in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and they do use tents, I am concerned that maybe the property owner would say, I'm just going to put up a tent, and you don't have to put up the tent. That's part of the package, and then on some property, there would be this tent constantly up. And this is a concern, and I think if we just put some wording in there that tents need to come up and they need to come down, it would prevent. I know this doesn't have anything to do with you, but if we're setting precedent, and we just want to make sure that
we're happy to do that. That's not a problem. It's an agricultural field. We do not want tents ruining the hay, and you know, basically, when there's an event, everything comes down immediately. We have no problem adding a note as Carol Ann had.
Victoria, they did two cuttings of hay a season in that very same area. So, Jonathan.
I just want to add one thing. My concern with just making sure, and I like the addition of this temporary, is because of its location close to the ocean within the, or close to the 75-foot mark and within the 275-foot shoreline overlay district area. But I think what we have to do as a board is if a special events facility comes before us again, that we have to take each one on the application at its face and not say that a person cannot have a tent up all the time. I just think we have to take that at its face. And one of the reasons is that the representations made by this applicant is that each person coming in for their own event is bringing in the tent on their own, and that's the representations that I'm going with from the applicant itself. So I think adding that note to this would sort of satisfy me from what the applicant's presenting, but to me it doesn't set a precedent for future applicants under this special events facility.
And one other question, did we ever define how long a special event is? Because
yes.
I mean,
yes.
We did?
It's in the
it is? Okay.
Note yep. Number
12.
So many hours.
Well,
it can only be done. Yeah, there are hours of operation, Henry. Could I, if we are happy with this additional condition, and Elaine, did you want this as a condition or also added to the plan?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And Caroline, you have that lingo before you, right?
I got it.
Oh, hang on to it. Could I call upon you to do the motion for the board to consider? It does run on for a little bit under our new format of numbered specific findings, but they're not that voluminous. Could I ask you to make the motion?
Thing?
Yep.
Or just...
Well, if you get tired of reading, give it to Henry.
Okay, motion for the board to consider findings of fact. The Sprague Corporation is requesting site plan review of a special event facility located at the Wentworth Lodge, 10 Winters Lane, which requires review for compliance with Section 19-9 site plan regulations and Section 19-8-15 special event facility standards. The plan for the development reflects the natural capabilities of the site to support development. 3, access to the development will be on roads with adequate capacity to support the traffic generated by the development. Access into and within the site will be safe. Parking will be provided in accordance with Section 19-7-8 off-street parking. The planning board finds that the provision of 20-foot wide parking aisles is adequate based on the normal imprecision of attendant directed parking in an unlined hayfield, as long as clear access for emergency vehicles is provided at all times. 4, the plan does provide for a system of pedestrian ways within the development. 5, the plan does provide for adequate collection and discharge of stormwater. 6, the development will not cause soil erosion based on the erosion plan submitted.
Would it carry on?
7, the development will be provided with an adequate quantity and quality of potable water. 8, the development will provide for adequate sewage disposal. 9, the development will be provided with access to utilities. 10, the development will not locate, store, or discharge materials harmful to surface or groundwaters. 11, the development will provide for adequate disposal of solid waste. 12, the development will not adversely affect the water quality or shoreline of any adjacent water body. 13, the applicant has demonstrated adequate technical and financial capability to complete the project. 14, the development will provide for adequate exterior lighting without excessive illumination. 15, the development will provide a vegetative buffer throughout and around the site and screening as needed. The development will not substantially increase noise levels and cause human discomfort.
Right.
Storage of exterior materials on the site that may be visible to the public will be screened by fencing or landscaping. 18, the scope of the special events will not exceed the maximum limits for special event facilities. 19, the temporary nature of the parking and sanitary waste facilities is adequate to comply with the site plan standards. 20, no special event structures are proposed that are subject to building codes. 21, additional restrictions have not been imposed on the operation of the special events facility. Is that?
I think it's have, yeah.
Have been imposed on. 22, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations and Section 19-8-15 special event facilities. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sprague Corporation for site plan review of a special event facility located in the Wentworth Lodge, 10 Winters Lane, be approved subject to the following conditions. 1, the approval does not include or grant permission for hosting special events in the Wentworth Lodge building. 2, a note shall be added to the plan that existing vegetation located within 30 feet side and front yard setback area of lot 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3 that provide a buffer for the special event facility shall not be removed in order to preserve a vegetative buffer. The areas of vegetative buffer shall also be delineated on the plans with consideration that the special event facility is located on three lots and buffer areas should be identified at the boundaries of the facility. Three, that the plan be amended to require that a minimum of one port potty for every 40 guests be provided at the special event facility. Four, that a note be added to the plan that no permanent structures are proposed or included in this application. This approval assumes that tents will be installed for events, that tents to be installed for events are temporary and will need to be removed after events. Five, that no special event shall be hosted on the property until the plans are revised to satisfy the above conditions and submitted to the town planner.
Thank you. That was a long one. So we now have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion on the seconded motion? Maureen?
I have a request on condition number three. You changed every 40 attendees to every 40 to guests. And the ordinance actually talks about attendees because we've combined both guests and staff people. So I would ask if you would be willing to change it back to attendees.
Okay. Where and number three?
On condition number three, the second line.
Oh, condition number three.
I just wanted to
find it.
I was hoping you'd be willing to accept.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
I have one other request. Could we change the word porta potty to portable toilets?
It's a friendly amendment.
Carolyn, how do you feel about
that? That is fine with me.
The porta potty may be a copyrighted, you know, trademarked.
Trademarked.
So portable toilet, right? Okay, and Carolyn has assented to those technical changes to her motion. And Jonathan?
I still second.
Okay, you second the motion? Discussion on the second motion? Call for a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. John, thank you. You're all set. Okay, the thank everybody here for their patience. We're moving as quickly as we can. The Cape Elizabeth High School generator site plan amendment. Excuse me. The town is requesting an amendment to the existing site plan approval for the school campus to install concrete pads for a generator and transfer switch. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 19.9 site plan regulations. We'll begin by having the applicant summarize the project. Will then be a public comment period on the issue of completeness. The board will then make a finding on completeness. If it's found to be not complete, it will be referred to a later meeting. The board should decide if a site walk should be scheduled. And completion, once it's been established, the board will open the public hearing for this meeting on the application on its merits. The board will then have its discussion of the application, and at the end it can approve the conditions, table, or deny the application. So we'll hear from the applicant. Sir, if you would identify yourself and summarize the project.
Sure. Sorry, I'm trying to get things up on the screen here for you also. I'm not used to that. Yeah, but I can't even get it to come up on the screen. I apologize. Good evening. My name is Greg Miles. I'm the Director of Facilities and Transportation for the Town and School Departments of Cape Elizabeth. The Town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting amendment to the site plan to allow for the installation of a concrete pad for a new generator to provide backup power for the school district's high school, which would also include protecting the server banks that we have, as well as the asset itself as a school, should we have a power failure. I have several pictures for you, if you'd like. That's what my glasses on now. This shot that you see here is actually referenced within the application, and it gives you an idea of where the generator pad is located, a safety bollard that's going to be in front of it, the automatic transfer switch pad, which is a small pad for a box that actually mounts to the wall, and I'm going to try to get other pictures here. I apologize, I'm not an Apple person, so... Okay, so how do I make this one bigger? This is a sketch that shows it scaled out of what it would look like with the generator pad in place. There is a sewer line, and you can see we depicted the manhole or access to the sewer line that runs 10 feet away from where the new pad is going to be located. The other line that you see in there is also the new power line that we have to run from the generator to connect to the building power itself. Hey, I'm getting the hang of this. This drawing here actually this picture shows where we're going to be removing some existing propane tanks, which is two 100-gallon tanks next to the building. Those will be removed completely, and that gas service will be tied into our existing 1,000-gallon propane tank. It does eliminate having two gas services into one building, and it also allows us to actually connect into one fire protection system within the building. Should there be a fire, it shuts off one tank system instead of having shut down two. This one here shows where we're going to put in some, remove some plantings and add some plantings to better make the space look much better. We have some shrubs that are tree-based that are not in great shape. A couple of them are, a couple of them aren't. The area is actually kind of a utility area. Propane tanks there, we have transformers there. We have a power service coming through there in a sewer line. This is what I'd like to show you. This is, and I apologize for the quality of the picture, this actually is a shot of what it looks like if you were standing looking towards the propane tanks that are going to be removed and the shrubs that are going to be removed. The generator would actually be on the opposite side where you see the transformer, so it actually sits behind the transformer and the propane tank adjacent to the building.
If you want to use the laser pointer that's on the podium.
How fancy. So those are the shrubs that we're going to remove. That is the propane tanks that are going to be removed. That propane is going to be rerun inside the building and come out here to connect to that existing propane tank that we have. To me, it's a much safer way of doing it instead of having two propane systems that we've had there for quite a while. This is a better shot of what those propane tanks look like that are being removed. That's our transformer. That's the transformer vault. Right there where you see that green, that's where the automatic transfer switch would actually be located. It's a much closer shot of what the propane tanks are doing. They're actually right now laying against the building. They're not actually supported by the slab that was there. It sank. So we're taking that all out. That's a good shot that shows you where those trees are right there, and that's one of them that's underperforming. Not to mention one of them is this one right here is sitting right on top of the sewer in the manhole. So it'd be a good idea to get that out of there for access to that manhole. And last but not least, that's a shot of what the transformer the vault that's under the transformer, we, coming through here is all the power lines that are feeding the school, which come under the parking lot. There's our propane tank. There's a bollard here, and right on the other side, you can't see it, there's another bollard that protects that propane tank. And I think that is the last site picture. Yes?
How tall is that existing generator?
The existing generator? The existing generator is not even sitting there. The existing generator is actually sitting in the parking lot.
Okay, then not the generator. What's the
The transformer? Transformer is about 5 feet tall.
Okay. I was trying to figure out how big is this new one going to be?
The new generator will be slightly taller. It will be about 7 feet all tall with the pad and everything.
That's it?
I could give more if you'd like.
it's your presentation.
What I can say right now is that the reason that the school department is going through this to put this in is to protect the asset of the school, to protect the server banks, which are for the school and town that are located within that building. The existing generator that was installed under a Homeland Security grant actually only runs the boilers, doesn't run the pumps, the controls. It's not large enough. Unfortunately, it doesn't protect the asset at all, being the school facility. Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions by board members?
I'm just trying to make sure I understand exactly where this generator is. So on this sheet, it's this long guy.
On that long sheet, sure, I'll pull it out so I can...
You're moving the propane tank over and back of it.
Yeah, if you look at that long sheet, you'll see where the existing propane tank is. The one that's labeled as propane, that's the one that is located right...
That's the big tank.
There. That's a 1,000-gallon propane tank.
So when you remove that, are you removing those bollards?
Nope, that's staying. That propane tank is staying. The tanks that are being removed are these ones against the side of the building.
The two small ones.
They're two 100-gallon tanks.
You're right. Your drawing here says existing propane tanks to be removed. The little ones. Yep. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm backwards.
Yeah, you should see two round circles on the drawing.
Yep. Got it.
Yep. Those are being removed and connected. The appliances tied to that are being connected to the 1,000-gallon tank. The tank has sufficient capacity to do it.
I'm looking at your, I think this was provided by the salesman, with regards to the actual generator, there's an arrow next to the level 2 sound enclosure. Is that what
Correct.
It's going to be?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And that's the highest you can
That get. Is the highest I can get. I looked for a 3 or 4. They don't make them.
And you did provide some information with regards to the decibel level?
I did. It's right included in your package, which basically shows that at the decibel level, or the decibel level at the closest property owner to that generator on that side of the building is, I believe it's 14.7 decibels.
You're very far away from the closest property.
We are. Yeah, we're 292 meters away from the property owner at that point.
With the football field in between them, too?
With a football field, a set of grandstands, part of a softball field, a parking lot, quite a bit between.
Yeah, we are at the moment on the issue of completeness. Any more questions from the board? There's a public comment opportunity on the issue of completeness. Any members of the public wish to be heard on the completeness of the application? There being none, we'll close the public comment period. Excuse me. Board, feel you're ready to make a vote on the issue of completeness? Sure. Henry, can you do your mic?
I'm looking at site picture number 4. And propane tank will stay, has two bollards either side of it. Crash barriers, I guess you call them.
Yeah, there's actually a third one which you can't see.
There's not one in front of it. So you protect the two sides, but don't look as if you're protecting the front, unless I'm misreading that picture.
There's actually three there. You can't see one of them, which is on the side of the tank. This is an existing structure that was installed when the propane was added to the facility back in 1968. And that's how they placed the bollards at that particular time. For, you know, whatever reason, to me, I'd...
You don't have a plan to put one in the front of it?
I had not put a plan to put one in front of it. I had not planned to put one in front of it.
Okay, I guess it's been there since 19...
1968.
Yeah, I guess there's not much danger now, then.
Probably not.
So you're not proposing, I mean, all of this stuff on the drawing, the concrete pavement, that's all there already, right? This is just an old drawing.
Which one?
On this drawing here.
On the actual site drawing, the concrete pad, or generator pad, is the piece that we're adding, and a small pad to sit underneath the automatic transfer switches, the two that we're
right, right,
having.
Right. But all this other work,
that's
just
all.
An old
that's
drawing.
That's actually the building itself.
This concrete pavement with 5x5.
That area out front is actually a patio that comes off of the cafeteria.
Right. That's currently. All there.
That's all currently there.
Is the,
yep.
Okay.
Any other comments? Is somebody like to make a motion for incompleteness, Jonathan?
I'll make a motion. Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth to amend the previously approved site plan to install a replacement generator at the high school located at 343 Ocean House Road be deemed complete.
Second.
Okay, we have a second in motion. Any discussion on the second in motion? I'll call for a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. Excuse me.
You seconded, right?
Jordan. Carolyn Jordan.
I just didn't hear.
Okay, so the completion is approved. We can start the substantive discussion on the merits. Do any members of the board wish there to be a site walk?
No.
No.
I think most folks are familiar with the school property and what's going on. Okay, we will then say there will be no sidewalk. So we'll now get on to a discussion of the merits of the application. Is there any member of the public who would like to be heard on the merits of the application? There being none, we'll close the public comment period. Discussion of the merits. Any comments, questions?
I just have one little question. Reference map 1B. So you're going to go ahead with the plantings along the, I'll call it in front of the transformers?
We are, yes. We're going to plant some azaleas there.
I know you had talked about maybe not, so.
No, we're definitely planning.
Yeah.
It's actually part of the scope that have our contractor having to do.
Okay. That's it.
Well, just one other issue. This was originally brought to us at a workshop, and the the pad has actually moved.
Correct.
And can you just kind of explain to us?
Yeah, it was felt in working with Bob Malley, our Public Works Director, that having the pad over the top of that existing line from 1968, should we ever have a problem with it, posed a potential problem. So the idea was to turn the pad away from it and keep it sufficiently away from that sewer line. Should we ever have to have a problem, now we won't have to move the generator or break up a pad to get to the line.
Thanks.
Makes a lot of sense. Any further questions, discussion on the merits of the application? I'd call for a vote. Motion.
Like a motion?
Yes. Excuse me.
Before we vote?
You know what I mean.
Motion for approval, findings of fact. The Town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting amendment to the previously approved site plan for the school campus to install a replacement generator at the high school located at 343 Ocean House Road. It requires review under section 19-9 site plan regulations. Number two, the application substantially complies with section 19-9 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth to amend the previously approved site plan to install a replacement generator at the high school located at 343 Ocean House Road be approved.
You have a second? Jonathan, seconded? We have a seconded motion, and is there any discussion on that seconded motion? I'll call for a vote then. All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. Thank you very much.
No, thank you. And I, Ms. Jordan over there seems to be reading all of it tonight.
Practicing.
She took our public speaking course.
There you go. I don't want to eject it wrong for you.
Okay, the next item of business is the Old Mill Road four-lot subdivision. Mark Jordy is requesting minor subdivision review of a proposed four-lot subdivision located at 41 Old Mill Road. The application will be reviewed in compliance with Section 16.2.3 minor subdivision. And Maureen, if I'm correct, all we're considering tonight is completeness. Is that right? Okay. Before we get into this matter, just as a matter of disclosure, I'd like to say that Mr. Jordy and I worked together for the same investment management firm in Boston for quite a number of years. In the context, it was within the company, it was sort of an attorney-client relationship. Mr. Jordy was developing new offices and business in Asia, and I was providing legal oversight, so we know each other from way back. I haven't seen Mr. Jordy for about 13 years until this evening, so it's been a while. It's good to see you, Mark. Anyway, I have no doubt that I can consider his application impartially. I was known to tell him he couldn't do stuff back in the old days, but if any members of the board are concerned about this, I'll gladly recuse myself. Okay, we'll move on to the details. We'll do the following procedure. We'll have the applicant provide an overview of the project. There will be an opportunity for public comment, limited to completeness of the application. The board will then make a determination on completeness. The board will then decide if a site walk should be scheduled, and at the close of the discussion,
we already had a site plan on this.
I'm sorry.
I believe we had a site plan. All right, I'm sorry. We
have had a site walk, yes. And Maureen seemed to think that the opportunity to have another one should be discussed. And I suspect we'll find that one did it. But okay. So with that, can we hear from the applicant and representative on what's this plan all about?
Sure, thank you very much. Peter, it's a pleasure to see you again, but I agree you never had any trouble telling me that there were things I couldn't do in the past, so I appreciate the disclosure. I'm Mark Jordy. I'm the owner of the property. I will turn this over to John Mitchell, who's very ably led this project and helped me understand the requirements of the planning process. Very simply, what I seek to do is to take a parcel of land that I purchased that had a single-family residence on it and create two new single-family lots. And then along with that, to take a substantial portion of the property and put it into a nonprofit corporation that would then, in essence, be common land for the three lot owners, that is the single-family residence that I'm currently occupying that was there before, and the two new buildable lots, for that common land to comprise most of the meadow. I think you did have a site visit at one point. A portion of the oceanfront, and then the road, which serves a number of existing properties as well as the two new properties. So that's the scope of what I seek to do. John? I think maybe before that, I might say one other thing. In thinking about this, I mean, I bought this property without a specific plan or, frankly, even intention in mind. I thought this might be I was attracted to the natural beauty of the site, and I thought there might be possibilities over time, and as I've considered them, I've developed this plan. But what's always struck me and has factored large in my planning is it's a very beautiful site full of considerable natural beauty. And as I thought through what I might do to further develop the site, but also to retain the natural beauty, this is the plan that I came up with. I think it represents a good balance between development and preserving what I consider to be a very beautiful natural setting. And I suppose that in part I would then draw your attention to one of the waivers that we've requested, which is a road waiver. And really, it's because if you drive into this property, it's a beautiful private road with forest on either side after you get through a kind of a meadow and open lawn area. Fully appreciate the objectives of riding the road, and I walked the road with the fire chief, and he pointed out to me what some of his issues and concerns would be, which made good sense to me. You know, at the same time, I'd say, but you know, kind of clear-cutting a much wider path down there would, in my view, considerably detract from the natural beauty, and so the waiver that we're requesting seeks to strike some balance between the very legitimate concerns that were expressed by the fire chief, which I understand, and we've tried to make some accommodations for those concerns in our proposal, but also to continue to preserve what I think is a site with considerable natural beauty. So with that, I'll turn it over to John.
John Mitchell of Mitchell & Associates. Also with us this evening is Rick Chenet of Drummond & Woodson, attorney. I'm going to begin the presentation by talking a little about some of the existing conditions of the property. I know most of you have attended the site visit last fall and have a pretty good feel for the characteristics of the property. And then I'll follow that by a presentation of the proposed subdivision. So the property is located on the easterly side of Old Ocean House Road and extends down to the ocean. It's 24 acres in area. The boundary or the abutters to the north are single family residences. To the east is the Atlantic Ocean. To the south is the Alewife Brook, which flows into the ocean. And to the west, this is property owned by Mr. Staley. It's where the barn is located. This is a single family residence and, of course, Old Ocean House Road. The property is located in the residential A zoning district as well as the shoreland zone district. We have a 250-foot shoreland overlay buffer associated with the shoreland zone. I should say that Owen Haskell established the normal high water line. They were out in the field. They established the, you know, based on the new CAPES definition of the normal high water line, taking the astronomical high tide, increasing it by 3 feet. So that is as shown on the plan, and from there we went back 250 feet. It's also in the Resource Protection District, and there are various areas within the Resource Protection. We have an RP1. RP1 are located associated with the Alewife Brook. We have RP1 buffer overlay district. We have the RP2 wetland district, and we have the RP3 floodplain district. The property is approximately 600 feet in width by 2,300 feet in length. The southerly half of the property is characterized by an open meadow, and the northerly half of the property is mostly wooded, dominated by oak trees. The property drains generally in a southerly direction towards the brook, except for the easterly section of the property, which has a drainage divide, and this was pointed out during the site visit, where half of the property drains towards the resource of the Alewife Brook, the other half drains inland towards these natural low areas here. So we have a drainage divide. This was established by Al Frick when he was out mapping the wetlands, and he mapped the drainage divide, and that's included in your packet. Old Mill Road is a private road. The first portion of the road up to the bridge is paved. That is, I believe is 14 feet wide in this section here. The balance of Old Mill Road is a gravel surface, and it varies in width from 10 to 12 feet. It has a town-approved dead-end turnaround at the end, and the overall length is 1,540 linear feet. Existing utilities on the property.
Sorry, where's the 1,540 feet to?
From Old Ocean House Road to the end of the existing road is 1,540 feet. Existing utilities on the property, there's an 8-inch main, water main in Old Ocean House Road. There's a fire hydrant right at the entrance. There is a 1.5-inch or 1.25-inch service that comes across the Staley property and then runs along the wood's edge to provide domestic water to the Geordie property and to the seasonal cottage owned by Mrs. Davis. Since there is no public sewer, the Geordie property has a on-site wastewater disposal system. And there's overhead electric, telephone, and cable utilities that currently service the Geordie property and the Davis property from the adjacent property. A density calculation was prepared by us. This is in my cover letter. It's on page 3 of my cover letter. We deducted the unbuildable land and came up with a density, a maximum number of lots of 10. So 10 lots by code could be developed on this property. The next few slides are just a series of existing conditions. This is Old Ocean House Road here, where in the beginning of Old Mill Road. So this is the paved section of Old Mill Road. Going up a little further, this is the bridge and the pond to the left. The pavement ends at the bridge. And then the balance of Old Mill Road is this 10-foot wide, I should say 10 to 12-foot wide gravel road that leads up to the Geordie residence. This is a photo of the meadow looking east. This is a high point of the property, then it falls and slopes towards the ocean. These are where the two building lots will be situated. Alewife Brook is to the right. And then this is a slide of the ocean front. So for the proposal, when Mark said, when he approached us with this project, basically he stated to us that his goal for this, as he mentioned, was to create two additional building lots and that preserved the character and the beauty of this very special piece of property. And this is the plan that we're submitting as our Old Mill Road subdivision. So it consists of three residential lots, and the fourth lot is the common open space. So lot one, we configured a property around the existing residence. This is Mark's home. It has ocean frontage and has frontage on Old Mill Road. Lot two is an L-shaped lot configuration, frontage on Old Mill Road. We have shown a possible building site down closer to the water. It doesn't have ocean frontage, but it has a beautiful view of the ocean front. And then lot three is a 2.66 acre lot, and the ideal building site is roughly in the middle of the property, and we'll have a nice view of the open meadow. The lot four is the common land. Everything in the darker green, it will be common land owned by the association. I just want to clarify that it won't be owned jointly by the landowners, but by the homeowners association. They'll be responsible for the maintenance of all common land. So we have 12.5 acres of common land. As you can see, we have provided a 40-foot wide strip connected to the common land, and this was done to allow maintenance vehicles to access the common land. Let's see. Old Mill Road, we actually have shortened Old Mill Road by a little over 100 feet. We're basically the improvements begin right beyond the bridge. So we're leaving this section of Old Mill Road, the paved section, as it is, and starting the widening and improvements at this point here. So our proposal is to widen Old Mill Road a total of 18 feet wide, and that consists of a 14-foot wide travel way plus 2-foot grass shoulders on either side for a total of 18 feet.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
So the right-of-way of Old Mill Road, what property is that part of? Is that belonging to the property of the common lot?
I'm sorry, say that again, Joe.
The right-of-way of Old Mill Road.
Yes.
Out to Old Ocean House Road. What's the ownership of that? Is that part of lot four? Is it part of the common land?
It will be part of lot four. Everything within the right-of-way will be part of the common land, which is lot four.
So the two lots?
These two lots.
So the two lots off of Old Ocean House Road have right-of-way?
Yes, they do. They do. Actually, this lot has a driveway onto Old Ocean House Road. The Staley lot, their driveway is off of Old Mill Road, and they have rights, as does the owners of this adjacent subdivision. They access Old Mill Road here and then turn right before the pond. Excuse me? Ann Louise Davis, who sold the property to Mark, their driveway is located right here.
And Victoria Poole. according to the notes on the plan?
Yes, that's the pool property.
Oh, that, all of that?
Yeah. So, as I said, we're asking for a waiver, which I'll get into a little later, but we're asking to reduce the width of the road from 22 feet for a local road down to, well, it's a 14-foot travel lane with 2-foot wide grass gravel shoulders on either side. The fire chief asked us to, the existing hammerhead turnaround is located approximately here. As I said, we're shortening the road. Chief Gleason asked us if we would consider relocating the turnaround to this point, which is at a point opposite the Davis driveway, and it allows better circulation for his fire vehicles. And so we accommodated him on that. With respect to utilities, proposed utilities, we've worked very closely with the Portland Water District. We are proposing to extend an 8-inch water main from Old Ocean House Road down Old Mill Road. The fire chief has asked for a hydrant, which we're providing. It's located roughly in this area here. We're providing, there'll be service lines to, new service lines to the barn lot, service lines to the two new lots, and a new service line to the Geordi lot, as well as the Davis lot. So all of the water infrastructure will be upgraded to meet Portland Water District standards.
Is that a change from when you came in at the workshop?
Yes, it is. At that time, Jonathan, we were considering bringing the water in here and underneath that existing stream. The electric telephone and cable utility, we're also running underground from Old Ocean House Road up Old Mill Road. We've got a couple transformers that are being proposed. Right now, as I mentioned, the electric comes in overhead to the Geordi property. It'll all be underground. And as there is no public sewer in the area, we are proposing on-site wastewater disposal systems for the two new lots. And then finally, the stormwater management. The upgrade of Old Mill Road will include a new surface, will include regrading the roadway so that it sheets to a drainage swale, and it will flow down along the southerly side of Old Mill Road and ultimately into this stream that outlets out of the pond. We are proposing a rain garden, which is a low impact drainage feature, roughly in this area here. It's at a natural low area. It's been sized to accommodate the runoff coming down, the purpose of a rain garden is to allow the runoff to infiltrate back down into the groundwater. Let's see. Waiver requests. We're requesting four waivers. The road width, which I just mentioned, we'd like to reduce it to 14-foot travel way. And there is a section in the subdivision ordinance, section 16-3-2, under road design that allows the planning board the flexibility to allow the applicant to allows the planning board to grant a waiver as long as we meet certain standards, and I just wanted to review those standards with you. Under road width, there are four standards under this section. The first is traffic safety. There's a typo there. I want to point out that in the design of the Old Mill Road, the redesign of the Old Mill Road, we are, aside from the width of the road, we're including all of the other standards under the road design portion of the ordinance. Gravel base, sub base, and all of the other grading, drainage, but we are asking for a waiver on the road width. The municipal maintenance, this will continue to be a private road, so therefore the town won't be responsible for any of the maintenance. This will be the homeowners association that will be responsible for that. Another standard is town's rural character, and I believe that by reducing the width of the road allows us to maintain that beautiful canopy of trees that's out there now, and it also will minimize the disturbance of a large piece of ledge outcrop that is on the southerly side of the roadway. So this will all add to the rural, maintaining the rural character. And then finally, the comprehensive plan. This is a three-lot residential subdivision, preserving 12.5 acres of open space, and it clearly is consistent with the comprehensive plan, which encourages preserving open space. The second waiver request has to do with the road alignment. Currently, Old Mill Road is, it deviates from the center line of the 50-foot wide right-of-way. And I believe the reason for that was when this was built, they avoided that ledge outcrop that I referred to. If you remember it from the site visit, we would like to keep the alignment the way it is. We are able to widen the road and do all the grading and drainage without encroaching onto that ledge outcrop. The third waiver request has to do with the HHE 200 form. This is the wastewater disposal final design. We talked about this at the workshop meeting. We have demonstrated to you in our packet, we have all the soil profiles and the test pits that were done on lots 2 and 3 that demonstrate that we have suitable soils. However, we'd like to wait until the sale of the home sites before we do the final design of the wastewater disposal systems. It is premature at this point to do final designs without knowing where the homes are going to be sited. And then the final waiver request has to do with plan scale. Our scale of the subdivision plat plan is at 1 inch equals 40 feet. 1 inch equals 80 feet versus 1 inch equals 40 feet. And that is so that we could fit the entire property on a 24 by 36 inch plan. And then finally, I just want to mention that we do have, as far as the road width is concerned, we have met with the fire chief on numerous occasions. We've walked the site and we do have the support of Chief Gleason for reducing the road width. And this is a couple slides showing this is the existing drive at 10 to 12 feet. And this slide, the one on the left, shows our proposed 14-foot wide roadway with the 2-foot grass gravel shoulders. This is the 22-foot wide required travel way. So that concludes the presentation of the subdivision. I would like to respond to a couple comments that I've received in Maureen's memo, if I could, especially the ones that have to do with the completeness items. The first one is solid waste. You know, I put not applicable in our application, but I guess what you're looking for is a statement from me of what, how much solid waste is going to be, especially as a result of the construction. And my response to that would be that it's going to be minimal clearing, especially if we are granted the waiver on the road width. There'll be minimal tree clearing along Old Mill Road. But what clearing there is, we're going to require the contractor to chip the stumps and the trees to use as erosion control mix. This is fairly standard in the industry now. With regard to solid waste, the two individual landowners will be responsible for disposal of their own solid waste. We got a partial completeness on floodplain. We did submit in the booklet a copy of the FEMA map that shows the where the floodplain is relative to the site. We have labeled that on the plan since we got this this memo from Maureen. Liquidation harvesting, to our knowledge, there has not been any clearing or harvesting of any of the timber on the site, and I've made that statement in my response letter. And then finally, landscaping. As you can probably tell, we've gone to great lengths to try to preserve as much of the vegetation as possible, especially along Old Mill Road. And my understanding is that the ordinance requires allows us to use those trees that we have preserved rather than putting in new trees. So in my application, I think I put not applicable since I understood that to be the case, but we have put that in our letter. We've also responded to Steve Harding's comments. They're all fairly minor in nature. I don't know, Peter, if it's appropriate for me to go through every one of Steve's comments and respond, but we have responded to all of them. We met with Bob Malley on the monumentation. He asked us to put a couple granite monuments out at the entrance, which we've done. There are a number of notes that we've added to the subdivision plan. It's mostly notes and labels, which were Steve's comments, which have all been addressed. And I did submit this letter to Maureen, not to the board members, because we just finished it this morning.
There are none of the engineer comments that you're opposing or disagreeing with? Oops, I'm sorry.
No, there are no comments that we're disagreeing with. We did add a note. Maureen asked us to put a note relative to the preservation of vegetation within the common area. I did prepare a note and put it on the revised plan. Maureen and I talked this afternoon. She would like to have that note expanded somewhat, which we're going to do. She wants a more definite delineation, which we're going to put on the along Elwife Brook. But no, there were no comments that we disagreed with.
Just along that, with regards to Lot 4, I understand it's going to be sort of put into an LLC that's going to be part of the homeowners association. Is there any sort of restrictions that are going to be put on that, that it's to be kept as open space, or what if, like, the homeowners decide, you know what, let's subdivide this, is that going to be allowed?
In your packet, Jonathan, under section 17, is a declaration of restrictions and covenants.
Okay.
And there's a section in there that talks about the common land, of what can be done and what can't be done. If, you know, if you have any specific questions, Rick is here, he could address those.
I'll take a closer look. Thanks.
Yeah, okay. Yes?
If you put up a picture, if you put the picture back up of the proposed 14-foot width with the car in there.
That one?
What happens if you meet the car coming in the opposite direction? I know there's just about room to pass, and I know it won't happen very often, but nevertheless, do you think about putting a parking, passing point where you would stop and allow? You've got a 14, I just did it here, and you've got about 3 foot, I guess, if you're lucky, between the two if you go right to the edge of the road.
Yeah, I mean, 14 feet, it's obviously going to be very tight for two vehicles to pass. We have provided a turnout in a location along Old Mill Road. Actually, it exists today.
No, what my question was, I guess, at a certain section of that, you have the grass verge. Forgive me, because I come from England where they had very narrow roads, and you had passing places where you pull in and let the other car go through and then you back up again. So on a narrow road like that, if it's that tight, and who knows what the width of cars will be, if you had one or possibly two wider sections where you see a car coming along, you'll just stop and give yourselves a little bit
more
room.
What I was saying is that we have one area that accommodates that turnout area. We also have, I mean, there are three driveways along the way that will be widened. It's just going to be, you know, it's going to be tight when two cars pass.
Well, I sympathize, and I own this problem.
Mark, could you go to the podium, please?
But you don't have an English accent.
No, but I've got an English address. I sympathize with this. I've thought about this. So I've said to myself, well, I do have the driveways. So and then the section of road is actually not all that long. Although the road itself is long, the section that you're referring to is maybe half that length. I don't know the exact measurement, but so it's not a wide area, and within that you've got three driveways and a turnaround. And so I guess to my way of thinking, I say there is a certain courtesy protocol that one has to learn in that situation, and you know.
So I guess the
so
the,
I'm the feeling entrance, like it might be covered, but anyway.
I guess the entrances to the house, to the other two driveways, would be wide enough to sort of pull over a little bit while the other car goes out. Yeah,
enough to squeeze.
Seems to be okay. Thank you.
We'll have more access. John, are you, is that pretty much?
Yes.
Okay. I want to just create the moment for public comment. If there is any, would anybody in the public like to be heard on the completeness issue for this application? There being no takers, I'll close the public comment portion of this, and the members can continue talking. You know, questions for John or Mark? Carolyn?
On completeness.
On completeness, right.
Completeness.
Yeah, but this is not the merits, just completeness.
Merits.
Yeah. John? Could you just elaborate a little bit on the where the 250-foot setback requirement becomes 100 feet because of the topography?
Yes.
Could you explain, I don't know if you can blow the map up a little bit, but I was having trouble identifying a...
Peter, I can't hear you.
I'm sorry, I was having trouble identifying a, what I thought to be a ridge line from the contour map that would indicate the two flows.
Okay, so here's the 250-foot from the RP1 to the 250-foot overlay district line. And from there, it goes down to 100 feet, which is right here. There's a label on the plan, 100 feet. But from this point to this point, it transitions along the drainage divide. I don't know if you remember, Peter, when we were out there, I pointed out to where that drainage divide is.
I do remember in the ground where you pointed, but just looking at the contour map, it looks like you have two sort of little 30-foot elevation mounds with a swale between them.
Well, this line runs along the ridge, the actual ridge.
Okay.
And that was delineated by Al Frick out on the site using a GPS to locate that ridge.
When you look at the contour map on sheet L1.0, do you see what I'm talking about? I'm just having trouble correlating the transition from 100 to 250 with the contour lines, really, in that southeasterly corner of lot two, which is what it's all about, right? Because that's the intended building site.
Well,
you see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying.
Those two mounds.
I think that the ridge can truncate the 250-foot contour. Right, you can use the ridge as a boundary.
The ridge has been used as a boundary.
So it might actually be less than 250 feet from the.
Well, it is less than 250 feet. I mean, as I said, it transitions from 100 feet here to 250 feet here.
Yeah, and the part I guess I'm questioning or wondering out loud about is if you look at the contours on the map, right about where the proposed structure is, right here, you can see there's sort of a swale between these two high points, and this is clearly going down this way, right?
Right.
But it's
and this is the high point of that. Right there. Okay. See that topograph?
But you're not you're returning to 250 over here. It's
right.
Kind of this area in here where I'm...
Is the transition area.
Okay, so this is all you're saying draining that way?
That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
I got you.
And then this area is going this way.
It's going that way.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. Good job, Mark. Other comments by members? Questions? Does anybody have anything else?
Question.
Oh, yes, go on.
How do we want to handle a motion for completeness and the request for waivers? There's a draft motion.
Yeah, there's a...
Okay, and it has waivers in it. I took a shot. I didn't read through, but I didn't notice that.
Yeah, well, there is a motion for completeness, and it refers to waivers on the forms and scale.
Right, because remember, completeness is just submission of information.
Right.
And then the other waivers that the applicant is discussing would be waivers from standards. Okay.
Yep.
Thank
you. Okay, if we have no more comments or questions on completeness, we'd entertain a motion on that point. Joe, would you like to make it?
Sure. Motions for the board to consider. A, motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts
presented the application of Mark Jordy for the three-lot Old Mill Road subdivision located at 41 Old Mill Road be deemed complete. Shouldn't that say four lot?
Yes.
Four lot.
Sometimes I call it a four-lot subdivision, sometimes I call it a three-lot subdivision.
Yep.
In accordance with section 16-3-5, and based on the request submitted by the applicant, the planning board waived submission of the following information. One, completed HHE 200 forms. Two, plans of a scale not to exceed 1 inch equals 40 feet.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded. Any discussion on that motion? We'll call for a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. Thank you. And we now need a motion to table the application to the next regular meeting, at which time a planning board public hearing will be held. Jonathan?
Motion table. Be it ordered that.
Jonathan?
Yes.
Excuse me.
I just want to make sure the board was aware that this is usually the point where you decide whether you want a sidewalk. And you have already held a sidewalk.
Right.
Just want to make sure you had that option in case you were interested in doing that again.
I do not feel the need for another sidewalk.
Right. Does anybody feel differently?
It's a beautiful piece of property that I'd love to visit again, but I don't think there's a need for a sidewalk.
All right. I'm sure I thought we'd cover that before. Okay. The motion to table, John?
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Mark Jordy for the three-lot Old Mill Road subdivision located at 41 Old Mill Road be tabled to the regular July 19th, 2016 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
John, you wouldn't object if we call that a four-lot subdivision?
That should be four-lot.
Yes, I'm sorry, four-lot.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Call for a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Thank you,
John. The last order of business is the technical amendments package. And this is the public hearing. I will ask the town planner to give a brief presentation on what this...
10 o'clock.
Oh. We have to have a motion to...
Suspend the rules to take new items after 10 p.m.
Okay.
It's 9:58.
Well, right. Maureen can't talk fast enough to get this thing done in 2 minutes.
All you have to do is get it started, and it's before 10 o'clock.
We have a motion to suspend the rules to... Can you describe that motion again?
A motion to suspend the rules to take new items.
Made, seconded, in favor. Opposed, carries unanimously. Maureen, would you? we knew you'd vote yes, Henry.
Okay, so this is the technical amendments and what I have done for tonight, in addition to the package of technical amendments, which is in multiple colors, which you all have before you, is I've also drafted a memo. It says draft memorandum, which would be the cover memo that would go from the planning board back to the council. So it would be nice if you could let me know if there's anything in here you find particularly objectionable. But the summary works really well. The planning board had asked the council for authorization to put together this type of package. The council authorized that in August 2015. Technical amendments are generally not major policy changes like you've been working on in the past with the land use amendments and all the other amendments. So usually we do this every once in a while. The intent is to clean up provisions, to clarify provisions, and just to do updates. Usually the technical amendments are undertaken, one, to protect the town from unintended interpretations of our existing ordinances, and we learn about those as we apply the ordinances to existing situations, and secondly, to improve customer service, because we sometimes find that our ordinances aren't clear enough when we apply them to real-life situations. So the package you have in front of you includes amendments to the zoning ordinance, the subdivision ordinance, the conservation ordinance, and it pulls the two stormwater sections in the conservation ordinance and creates a brand-new ordinance called stormwater. Stormwater has become increasingly important as a regulatory item, and it seems like it's kind of grown up now and it needs its own ordinance. I have created a description of a summary of each amendment that goes on for, I think it's 6 pages, and it's intended to make it clear what the board has in this package, so we're not trying to hide anything. I also would like to take in one moment, a moment to recognize the input that the planning board has received from Public Works Director Bob Malley, from Stormwater Consultant Christy Rabaska, from the Tree Warden Mike Duddy, from our Town Engineer Steve Harding, from Tom Errico, who provides traffic engineering consulting advice, from John Wall, our Town Attorney, and Ben McDougall, our Code Enforcement Officer. So this is truly a major package of minor amendments. And if, for tonight's meeting, you do need to hold a public hearing before you consider a recommendation to the council. And if you're ready, there is a recommendation drafted for you on page 6.
Marina, just how many different workshops did we actually address these technical amendments?
You had 11 meetings counting tonight, and I believe 9 of them were workshops.
Okay, and all of them are open to the public, correct?
Every single meeting the planning board has is open to the public. And this item was even on agendas where you didn't get to it.
And if somebody did want to come in, a member of the public, and make a change to any ordinance, they would have that ability to bring that up to the council at any time, correct?
Yes.
Fine.
I would note there is an opportunity for the public to be heard tonight. There being no one here, we will open and close the public comment period. Maureen, do you have anything else to add? Any board members have any further comments, questions?
I just would commend Maureen and the other town staff who put together all these amendments and went over them and considered all the changes that we made as a board over those 11 meetings, including tonight. But I know this wasn't an easy job, but I have to give kudos to the town staff, especially Maureen, for actually putting this together. And it was, I thought, a very good process to go through, and hopefully it'll make everything better for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth when they come forward with any sort of plans or understanding the ordinances that are in this town.
Yeah, I agree. A lot of work and exceptionally well done, so thank you. Entertain a motion to, which is...
Do you like a motion?
Carolyn?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the supporting materials and draft ordinance amendments prepared and the facts presented, the planning board recommends the technical amendments to the town council for consideration.
Second.
This motion has been seconded. Any further discussion? Call for a vote. All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
It's a technical thing, unanimously from the people who are here, right? It's not a unanimous vote, because we're missing two members.
It's unanimous.
We have a quorum, and it's the board is acting as the board is unanimous. The last item is a public comment for any other matters not heretofore commented on publicly, and the public is invited to speak. There being nobody here, we'll close that, and I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
Motion we adjourn.
Second.
Second and unanimously passed, I'm sure. Thank you.